One Sabbath day he was going through the grain fields, and as they made their way, his disciples began to pluck at the grain. The Pharisees said to him, "Look, why are you doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath?" And he said to them, "Have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry and in need of food? He entered the house of God in the Bethar of the high priest and ate the bread of the presence, which is not lawful for any but the priest to eat. And he gave some to his companions." Then he said to them, "The Sabbath was made for humankind, and not humankind for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath." Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us go to God in prayer. Gracious God, may we hear your word, and may we have the courage to live your word now and always. Amen. We are all familiar with the scene. It is one of those game shows, and the contestant is at a crossroads. She can bank the $50,000, or she can risk it all for the $1 million question. Our contestant, Mary, decides to go for the big question. For $1 million, the question is, which of the following species of birds does not build its own nest, but instead lays its eggs in the nests of other birds? Is it A, the condor, B, the buzzard, C, the cuckoo, or D, the vulture? Mary was on the spot, and she did not know the answer. She had used her 50-50 lifeline, and she had already asked the audience for their help. All that remained was her phone a friend. And she called her friend, and she gave her the question and the four choices. The friend immediately and without hesitation said, "The answer is C, the cuckoo." The moment of decision was at hand, and Mary decided to trust her friend and said, "C, cuckoo, final answer." And the MC replied, after that long pause they always give you, "The answer is absolutely correct. You are now a millionaire." After the show was over, Mary called her friend to say thank you, and to ask her how she knew such a trivial question so well. Her friend said, "Everybody knows that cuckoos don't build their own nests, they live in clocks." Sometimes there are moments in life where the outcome of our choices determines what comes next. We are faced with one such instance in today's sermon. One day Jesus and his disciples were walking through a field of corn, and the disciples began to eat some of the ears of corn. Normally, this would have been acceptable behavior. In the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 23, verse 25, it says, "If you enter a neighbor's grain field, you may pick kernels with your hands, but you must not put a sickle to the standing grain." The disciples were following the social norms and conventions of their day. The problem was, this was not an ordinary day. This was a Sabbath day. Barclay explains it by saying that the Sabbath was hedged around with literally thousands of petty rules and regulations. All work was forbidden. Work had been classified under 39 different heads, and four of those heads were reaping, winnowing, threshing, and preparing a meal. By their actions, the disciples had technically broken all four rules and were to be classified as lawbreakers. Now, to us living in today's world, this would not be a big deal. However, in Jesus' time, the rabbis considered this a deadly sin, and it became a matter of life and death. So when the Pharisees saw this behavior, they became angry and they took issue with Jesus and his disciples. Now, I don't know what the Pharisees expected Jesus to do, But I'm fairly certain they did not expect Jesus to justify his behavior by giving them an example from Scripture, by giving them an example from their own traditions and history. Jesus reminds them of the story about David, who in a time of need ate forbidden food, thus demonstrating that Scripture can show that there are times when human need outweighs divine law. Jesus puts the argument to the test by stating that the Sabbath rules and regulations were not created to dominate one's life, but they were a place to make life more fulfilling. So that is where we are. Here is where we come to for today's sermon. Jesus' disciples broke the Sabbath law. The Pharisees took issue. Jesus protects his disciples by reminding the Pharisees of King David's behavior in a similar time of need. And did you notice I just gave a recap of a recap? Some passages of Scripture are timeless. They teach us important truths about our lives, about family and friends, about our faith. And they point the way to a deeper, more meaningful relationship with the living Christ. And then there are other Scriptures that are not so clear. The words are confusing, the message gets muddled, and the application of how it applies to our lives today is just not there. And I wish today's Scripture was the former, but unfortunately it is the latter. But that doesn't mean that we dismiss this Scripture, it simply means that we must dig a little deeper for the meaning. Today's Scripture might be hard for us to understand because it is not in sync with our lives today. We as Christians still respect the Sabbath, but it is no longer a life or death situation. We do not have religious experts scrutinizing our every move, and we do not have thousands of religious laws dictating the way we should live. But Jesus actually in the story reminds us of important things, of necessary things to remember in our Christian walk. First, our faith has to be more than a set of rules and regulations. To the Pharisees, this meant everything. The more a person could follow the rules, the more that individual was in touch with God. But our faith isn't dependent on the number of rules we follow. Our relationship with God has to be more than just rules, more than completing a checklist, more than meeting our obligations. Now, I'm not advocating a life where we don't need to follow the rules of our faith. We Presbyterians love our rules. We follow a book of order, and that helps us do everything decently and in order. We rely heavily on Scripture to guide our behavior. We honor God by following the Ten Commandments and by living by the Golden Rule. These and other regulations are important to our faith, but our primary focus need always be on a life of love, on forgiveness, on how we serve. Second thing we learn from Jesus' words is that we should never put rules above human need. I think this is one of the things that got Jesus trouble. He loved and helped people first and foremost. He healed a man on the Sabbath with a withered hand. He was willing to spend time with lepers. He treated the rejected of society with dignity and respect. He healed people so that he could return them to society. He ate dinner with sinners and tax collectors. He spent time with children, and the list goes on and on. Jesus followed the laws and showed perfect obedience to God, but he knew those most important qualities in life, love, mercy, grace, hope, forgiveness, and faith. When all of those attributes are part of the daily condition, then we become a people who put human beings first. What does God call us to do? To love others as God loves us, which means where we can help, we help. Where we can ease suffering, we ease suffering. Where we can serve, we serve. Third thing we learned today is that our faith means nothing if it's not being used. What good is praying if we're not listening to what God is saying? What good is reading scripture if we never apply it to our lives? What good is this church if we are not a beacon of hope? What good is it to say that we believe in the mission of Christ if we don't roll up our sleeves and serve our God? What good is it to say that we are Christians, but then we don't show it with our love? The hardest thing about living the Christian life is living the Christian life. Listening to God, applying scripture to our lives, being active in the world, doing Christ's mission, loving all whom we meet. Not an easy task, but well worth and always worth the effort. There is a legend, a story about a man named Artaban, who is known as the fourth wise man. If you Google this, many things will pop up on your computer screen. Stories, operas, and the fact that it was a TV movie years ago starring Martin Sheen. Don't let that stop you, I'm still going to tell the story. This is a legend, a myth if you like, but it's about the fourth wise man. So the legend is that there were supposed to be four men who went, four magi who visited the baby born in a manger. The fourth man, Artaban, read the stars in the sky, saw the signs just like the others. In fact, he was set to rendezvous with the others to join their caravan so that the four wise men could go and meet Jesus. He had an appointed time and place to meet up with Melchizedek and Caspar and Balthazar, and the four of them were going to go and see the baby Jesus. He even had his own gift that he brought, a sapphire, a ruby, and a lovely pearl that he was going to give to God's king. And so he sets out for the rendezvous point, and along the way, he meets a man that is lying on the ground, sick and disabled. And this is in Jesus' time, so it's not as if he can call 911 and get the ambulance to come and go on his way. So now he has to make a decision. If he takes the time and the care and the opportunity to help this individual, he will miss his rendezvous time, and he will not be able to join the caravan. But this is a human in need, so he takes the time, and he helps, and he cares for, and he helps to heal this sick person. And now he's missed his rendezvous. He can't meet up with the others. And it's not just like he can ride his horse to Bethlehem. He needs camels and supplies and people that will get him through the desert, because he doesn't have that now that he's not with the caravan. So reluctantly, he sells his sapphire so he can get the resources he needs to go to Bethlehem to see the baby. So he does, and he's on his way, and he makes it to Bethlehem, and it's too late. The Holy Family has gone. We know where they went. They fled to Egypt because Herod was looking for them. Herod was the king, a very jealous, envious, paranoid, murderous king. And he knew that the Messiah, God's king, was to be born. And this threatened his whole throne, but he didn't know who the king was. So his eloquent solution was he ordered his soldiers to go out to the entire land, and any child, any male child, 2 years or under, was to be slaughtered. And if he slaughtered them all, the king was not a threat to his throne. And at this time, Artaban was staying with a lady who had a son that was 2 years and younger. They heard the soldiers coming. They heard the carnage and the devastation that was happening next door. And Artaban had to act. So a very tall man he was, he stood in the doorway of the house, a very imposing figure. And when the captain of the guard came by, he gave him the ruby. And the soldiers went on their way. That baby was saved. That mother was overjoyed, and that ruby was gone. Two gifts meant for the king that went somewhere else. And so Artaban spent the next 30 odd years looking to find Jesus. And he finds out one day that there's to be a crucifixion of this man that had been causing trouble.
And it felt right to him. This must be Jesus. This must be the one, the King, the Messiah, is who he was looking for, God's King. And he felt this had to be it. So then he gets an idea. I can take my pearl, and I can do what I've done before, and I can bribe the guards, and I can maybe save this Jesus' life. So that's the new plan. And he heads out to Jerusalem to stop this crucifixion. But again, along the way, this little girl, sobbing and scared to death, comes running up to him and says, "Help, help, save me. My father is in great debt. He cannot pay what he owes, and there's soldiers chasing me, and they're going to take me and sell me as a slave to pay off my father's debt." And without hesitation, but very sadly, Artaban takes the pearl, the last thing he has, and he gives it to the guards so that the debt is paid and the girl is safe. And now, very sad, he has nothing. He has nothing to give to his king. He doesn't have to think about it very long, because remember what Scripture says, when Jesus died, the earth shook. And so when this earthquake happened, Artaban was in the city, and debris was flying all over, and he got struck in the head with a tile, and he dropped to his knees, and he knew this was it. And he knew that he was sad because he never found his king. And as he's there, it's very dramatic, as he's there in his last moments, he hears a voice saying, "Whatever you have done for the least of these, you have done for me." And so Artaban dies with a smile on his face, because he knew that his king got all three of his gifts. And this story is perfect for our scripture verse today. It fits beautifully into this box, because this man shows us that there's more to our faith than rules, that human need always takes precedence, and that our faith is not our faith if we're not using it and living it and loving every single day. And this story tells us that this man did this no matter what. And we all can do the same. So let us pray.
Amen. Gracious God, thank you that the gift you give to us is our ability to serve, to help, to use our faith and to love. Help us to do that each and every day.